In Search of a Champion, Volume 2, by Langley Longseer. Inigo and Blowoft. I just stopped in a little village on the border, and it seems that the brothers came through this way a few years ago. Inigo and Fergus are making a name for themselves. It seems that for quite some time, the village had been terrorized by a giant, known by the locals as Blowoft the Flatulent, for reasons you can imagine. Inigo and Fergus heard about this while renting a room for the night. Apparently a patron heard them talking. Inigo said, "I've never seen a giant before." Then Fergus replied, "We'll deal with it tomorrow, it's late." Inigo said, "Go get your beauty rest then, I'll take care of the giant." Fergus nodded and said, "Fair enough, yell if you need me." Then Inigo patted his brother on the shoulder and walked out. Fergus downed his ale and went to bed. An hour or so passed, then Inigo staggered in, dragging something heavy. He was grinning ear to ear. "I brought you a souvenir, barkeep." He heaved the giant's club onto the bar. Everyone gasped. "He's only slightly less smelly than dead, so I'd bury him first thing in the morning if I were you," said Inigo. Everyone cheered and laughed, and the innkeeper mounted the club above the bar. After a lot of negotiation, I managed to convince him to sell me the club. It's wonderful to have something he touched. It makes me feel closer to him somehow. He killed his first giant, single-handed. Inigo and Fergus are obviously as tough as they come. Inigo and the Witches of Glamour. I followed a lead to the town of Anvil, where I have discovered more evidence of the brothers and their daring deeds. Apparently they passed through here a year ago and ended the lives of a group of treacherous hags that had been seducing the local men, then sacrificing them. Inigo and Fergus rescued a man from the witch's table, and he was quite happy to tell me his tale. He said that two Khajiit men, one broad and golden, the other wiry and bluish purple, snuck into the cave where he was being held. The hags were in a high tent at the far end of the cave, noisily preparing a beastly incantation of some sort. The golden Khajiit, Fergus I assume, crept to the far end of the tent, sword in hand. Inigo readied his bow and waited in the shadows. Fergus raised a hand to Inigo. Inigo nodded, then loosed an arrow. It tore a hole in the tent, and there was a horrible scream from within. A witch ran out, wielding a dagger. Fergus decapitated her and called out, "Join us, ladies! You have two new suitors here. We are ready to take you out." There was a lot of angry yelling from within the tent. Then the witches burst out, spewing fire and ice from their hands. The poor man, strapped to a sacrificial table, watched in terror as a mighty battle began. He saw Fergus take the heads off two more witches, then raise his shield as a massive gout of flame erupted from the hands of a third. Inigo put an arrow through the hag's eye as his brother's shield disintegrated. Fergus tossed the melting hunk of metal away and ducked as Inigo shot a witch behind him. Apparently the brothers fought as if they had one mind. The man said it was like watching a beautiful dance, but with more screaming and blood. Soon the witches of Glamour all lay dead. The brothers laughed and hugged. They freed the man, looted the cave, and went on their way. After hearing this story, I ventured to the cave where it all took place and found the remains of the witches. I took their heads. Yet more evidence that Inigo is indeed real and the champion I seek. Inigo and Browulf the Broad. I'm so close. I just received another Inigo artifact for my growing collection, the helm of a barbarian called Browulf the Broad. My continued search for Inigo and Fergus has led me north to a small unmarked settlement in the mountains that border Skyrim. The brothers were here 2 months ago. This Browulf character had been in charge for a year. He was fierce and mighty and utterly insane. He and his crew enslaved the locals and forced them to dig a mine. He was convinced that the village lay on an ebony deposit. He had the men and women serve him in 1,000 horrid ways when they were not digging. They say that one day a local boy tripped while bringing Browulf a cup of mead. The brute reached out his slab-like arms and ripped the poor boy's head from his shoulders. One day, two Khajiit warriors came to town. They were greeted by one of Browolf's men at the gate. On seeing Inigo's unusual coloring, the thug laughed, jeered, and pointed. Fergus drew his sword in a blur and amputated the man's leg in a flash. "Next time you mock my brother, I'll remove your head. Do we have an understanding?" said Fergus. The man nodded, wept, and whimpered as the remains of his leg spurted blood onto the snow. Inigo stepped forward into the village. "We have heard tales of the great misery you bullies have inflicted on the rightful owners of this land," he shouted. "Run and live, or stand and die." A group of Browolf's men drew their swords, but did not advance. They obviously liked their legs. Browolf heard the commotion and stepped out of his hut. He was tall and possessed the bulky breath of a giant. His legs and arms were like tree trunks. His chest was like a brewery barrel, and his head was the size of a cooking pot. "What's all this? Everyone get back to work," he yelled. The locals all dropped their heads and hurried away. Fergus spoke up. "I am guessing you are the reason the people here scurry like mice." Browolf laughed. "Yes, and you had better scurry back the way you came, little kitty, unless you want to work my mine with the rest." Inigo drew his bow and addressed the retreating townsfolk. "Worry not, good people. This smelly pile of dung is about to give his last order." Browolf's face turned red with rage. "Kill them," he shouted. Fergus readied his sword and yelled, "If you have no affiliation with this brute, get indoors. We have no quarrel with you." People ran, and doors slammed. Frightened faces peered through windows. Browolf's men advanced. There were at least 20, but after Inigo and Fergus made short work of the first 10, the rest fled. Browolf was furious and rushed at the brothers, wielding a massive axe. Fergus rolled out of the way and Inigo put an arrow into the huge man's helm. This normally would have ended things, but Browolf was as solid as a rock and he kept coming. Fergus slashed at the huge man's arms and legs, but no wound went deep. There was just too much bone and muscle in the way. Inigo advanced, aiming for the eyes, but the barbarian kept his head down as he fought Fergus, and he only succeeded in peppering Browolf's helm with arrows. A massive hand shot out and took Fergus by the throat. It lifted him off the ground and squeezed. Inigo dropped his bow, drew his sword, and ran to his brother's aid. With flagging strength, Fergus drove his blade into the crook of Browolf's neck. Inigo ducked a flailing axe blow, jumped on the brute's back, and stabbed his sword under Browolf's jaw. Suddenly, Fergus was free. Browolf dropped his axe and fell to one knee. His gigantic hands groped for the two blades that now pierced his neck. Fergus rushed forward again and grabbed the hilt of his sword. In perfect unison, Inigo and Fergus withdrew their swords and swung them in opposite arcs. The blades rose, winked briefly in the sunlight, then hurtled down again. They collided at the point where Browolf's massive head met his massive neck, cleaving the two asunder. The brothers fell back into the snow, panting and laughing. The villagers rejoiced. They were finally free from tyranny. Inigo and Fergus set off south sometime later. I have Browolf's helm beside me as I write this. It cost a pretty penny, but it was worth it. I'll continue my travels tomorrow. It looks like I'm going south. I am a murderer. I met a farmer on the road to Skingrod yesterday. When I asked if he had seen a couple of warrior Khajiits recently, he laughed and said, "We took care of those thieving cutthroats a few days ago." Shocked, I asked him to explain. He said that two Khajiit men had been stealing from the local farms and villages for weeks. After finding their camp, the farmer and a group of his mates crept up and attacked the thieves in their sleep, using muffled scrolls they bought in town. He said they killed one, but the other got away. Doubt he'll be showing his face around here again, though. I explained that the Khajiit men I was looking for were not thieves. He said, "All Khajiit are thieves." Distressed, I asked the farmer to show me the camp. I found Fergus, dead and gore-streaked, under a collapsed and torn tent. I knew it was him instantly. He looked vital, dynamic and regal, despite the dried blood clinging to his golden fur. I have never felt such outrage, pain, and sadness. The farmer clearly saw a change come over me and stepped back. "You fool!" I shouted. "This man was a hero, both noble and brave. He was no thief. By the gods, what have you done?" The farmer took a step back. "He was a filthy Khajiit, nothing more." I felt my sadness turn to anger. Tears blurred my vision as I glared at the fool. He took another step back. "He was a scoundrel and a thief. Good for nothing. No use getting upset." Before I knew what I was doing, my hands had taken charge and engulfed the farmer in a torrent of fire. I watched him burn and scream as flame leapt from my palms. I have never before now used my magic against a person. I still feel sick, but Fergus deserved better than to die at the hands of a group of witless, racist inbreds. I would have immolated every last one of them if they had been standing there before me at that moment. I cleared the ragged remains of the tent away and knelt by Fergus. I held his cold, golden hand. "You saved Inigo, didn't you?" I whispered. "Where did he go, Fergus?" I dug a grave nearby and laid the brave warrior to rest. I looked around for his sword, but it was gone. Probably taken by one of his killers. There was no sign of Inigo anywhere. At least he survived the attack. I only hope his grief has not led him astray. I must find him soon. I will stay at the camp tonight and see if I'm visited by a new vision. Oh, Inigo, you are not as alone as you feel. Nothing. It has been years since I found Fergus, and I am no closer to locating Inigo. It is as if he dropped off the map. My visions of the Doomstrider are less frequent, so perhaps the death of Fergus somehow changed our destiny. I know not. I have settled back in Skyrim for now. I have paid a small group of adventurers to seek out and acquire any artifacts and information relating to Inigo. So far, none have returned. I have also employed the services of a powerful conjuration mage. He is hard at work in the Imperial City, trying to create a summon spell that will hopefully teleport Inigo straight to me when cast. The mage assures me such a spell is possible, but will only work if the caster is a true friend of the summoned individual. I told him that I am the only true friend Inigo has left. Unfortunately, the incantation will take some time to prepare. A nightmare? I had a horrific dream last night. Inigo was trapped in a vast, dark chamber. He was bleeding badly and surrounded by Draugr. He fought them off and fled up a spiral staircase, but there was someone else there. A wizard? Who wasn't quite as lucky. Where did the dream take place? It looked like Skyrim, but I can't be sure. Damn it, I need that spell. Hope. Thank the gods. Inigo is indeed still alive. In my latest dream, I saw him leaving Windhelm, carrying a dragonfly in a jar. He looked tired and ragged, but he's out there somewhere. With age, his fur has begun to take on rather a mauve hue. Time changes us all, I suppose. When I started this book, I had a thick head of black hair. I saw Inigo save a farmer from a frost troll. The farmer thanked him and offered him gold, but Inigo ignored the gesture and plodded away. Where is he heading? My vision ended shortly after he reached a fork in the road. Did he travel towards Riften or Whiterun? I'd set out in search of him immediately if the summon spell wasn't due any day now. Blast. Swindler! The spell arrived today and it is worthless. I have tried reading the tome 100 times and it does nothing. Well, not quite nothing. It vibrates gently, then slams shut. That conjuration mage is a swindling con artist and I want my money back. I will keep trying nonetheless. Perhaps I can force it to work somehow. By the gods, that charlatan is going to bay. I may not know much about conjuration, but I can kick a fellow in the crotch as well as the next man. He was grinning ear to ear. I brought you a souvenir, barkeep. He heaved the giant's club onto the bar. Everyone gasped. He's only slightly less smelly than dead, so I'd bury him first thing in the morning if I were you, said Inigo. Everyone cheered and laughed, and the innkeeper mounted the club above the bar. After a lot of negotiation, I managed to convince him to sell me the club. It's wonderful to have something he touched. It makes me feel closer to him somehow. He killed his first giant, single-handed. Inigo and Fergus are obviously as tough as they come. In Search of a Champion, Volume 2, by Langley Longseer. Inigo and Blowoft. I just stopped in a little village on the border, and it seems that the brothers came through this way a few years ago. Inigo and Fergus are making a name for themselves. It seems that for quite late. Inigo said, go get your beauty rest then. I'll take care of the giant. Fergus nodded and said, fair enough. Yell if you need me. Then Inigo patted his brother on the shoulder and walked out. Fergus downed his ale and went to bed. An hour or so passed, then Inigo staggered in, dragging something heavy. At some time, the village had been terrorized by a giant, known by the locals as Blowoft the Flatulent, for reasons you can imagine. Inigo and Fergus heard about this while renting a room for the night. Apparently a patron heard them talking. Inigo said, I've never seen a giant before. Then Fergus replied, we'll deal with it tomorrow.